Okay, so good evening, everyone. Welcome to the second session of Balance. As you know, we are a public journal club that focuses on chemistry-related research. Today, we will be seeing a paper presentation from Advait Kulkarni and Madhur Bhatt. Both are third-year students, BSMS students at IISER Kolkata, majoring in chemistry. They will present the paper titled Efficient Lewis Acid Catalysis of an Abiological Reaction in a De Novo Protein Scaffold. The research leading to this paper was conducted in the lab of Professor Donald Hilbert from ETH Zurich. The presentation will be followed by a discussion session where you all can share your thoughts, ideas, aberrations, questions, just anything with everyone else here. You can also post this on the Google Meet chat at any time during the presentation or after the presentation. You can also raise your hand at the end of the presentation and talk. We shall ask you to unmute like on a turn-by-turn basis. I, however, request you to not stop them midway in the presentation. You can use the chat, but please do not unmute yourself while the presentation is midway. So yeah, let's dive straight in and I'll hand it over to Advait, who will begin the presentation. Thank you.
Let me share the screen. Yeah, so the screen is visible, right?
Yes, Advait, it is.
Okay, thank you. So welcome everyone to this second session. We are going to discuss this paper, which is titled Efficient Lewis Acid Catalysis of an Abiological Reaction in a De Novo Protein Scaffold. By this title, we mean we are preparing an enzyme right from the scratch. Okay, so let's see how we do it. So before diving it into the details of this paper, I would like to give some background. So first of all, I would like to discuss the Diels-Alder reaction itself and its applications, and the Lewis acid catalysis. This is a technical thing. There are some other things that I would like to discuss, but which might feel out of context here. So I'll explain them whenever I need them. All right. So now the reaction, it was first described by Otto Diels and Kurt Alder in the year 1928. So they were awarded a Nobel Prize in the year 1950 for their amazing work. Why is this amazing? Because it involves formation of two CC sigma bonds, which is of great importance to the synthetic chemists. All right. So this is, we call this species as the diene. As you can see, there are two double bonds, and there is another species, dienophile, that is, which loves the diene. Okay. So this is what we get, a hexene derivative. So you can add other groups on the other sides, and you can make derivatives of this compound. And the mechanism is this way. So it's a one-step mechanism. I'll discuss that. So the characteristics of this reaction is, it is a specific case of cycloaddition reaction. By cycloaddition reactions, I mean when the product formed is cyclic, it is called as a cycloaddition reaction. This is a specific case of 4 plus 2 cycloadditions, where it includes formation of 4 pi electrons, 4 pi electrons from one diene, and 2 pi electrons from this dienophile. Okay, and the mechanism is concerted, meaning that each and every, like, whatever bond breakage and making is happening, it happens in the same step. There is no intermediate as such, there is just one transition state, that's it. Okay. Now let's look at the applications of this reaction. So basically, the widespread applications of this reaction was seen is in natural product synthesis. And by natural products, I mean metabolites of the living organisms that are useful in biological ways. Okay. So what is the use of this natural product synthesis? One, it helps in making the naturally important molecules directly in your laboratory. Two is understanding the mechanism, so that we can adapt that mechanism, we can improvise that mechanism and somehow optimize it. Okay, so this whole thing is very much applied in the field of drug discovery. It also, the Diels-Alder reaction also has applications in material science, material science field. I'll discuss that in a few minutes. But instead of searching how widespread this applications, the applications of Diels-Alder reaction is, we should check how even older papers applied this reaction. Now, even 1950s, even in 1950s, this reaction was used for formation of this beta cyclocitral. Okay, so a 1950 paper uses Diels-Alder reaction to form beta cyclocitral. So this is a compound that promotes cell division and lateral branching. So it is of biological importance, and it was synthesized in 1950s using Diels-Alder reaction. And from 1950s till 2021, all right, this is a very new, fresh, fancy paper, which includes which applies polymer chemistry, and it has this main thing, healability, which means it can heal itself if it is broken. For example, if we give a cut here, and if we treat this thing, heat it, then so first thing is it includes disulfide bonds, which is out of our discussion right now, but it also includes Diels-Alder and retro Diels-Alder. So whatever reaction we saw at high temperature, it completely reverts. Okay, so if there are smaller cracks, it is healed by disulfide bonds, but if there are bigger cracks, you heat them, it the polymer kind of melts. And by cooling it down, you can reform the whole polymer again. It has no cracks at all. Right? So now I'd like to move to the Lewis acid catalysis part. Okay. So I'll explain this on the basis of molecular orbital theory. Say suppose you have an electrophile. Now electrophile is one which needs electrons, right? And a nucleophile which is ready to donate electrons. Now see, relatively this homo-lumo gap is very high. Okay, so the reaction is not that favorable. So now what we do, we take a Lewis acid which has an empty orbital and form a new kind of bond here with the electrophile, so that the lumo of this combined molecule is lower than the pure electrophiles. Okay, so what was once this big gap is now reduced to this. So lesser the homo-lumo gap, better is the reaction. This is all we know. So this is also known as lumo-lowering catalysis. Okay, this is a general mechanism, and we'll make use of this in our paper, in our discussion today. So now let's get to the business. What were the previous attempts of catalyzing this Diels-Alder reaction? Okay, so even though if it has so much application in natural or artificial systems, there were very few enzymes or say catalysts that were discovered or were made that would catalyze the Diels-Alder reaction. There were some catalytic antibodies and computationally designed Diels-Alderases that were produced, but they gave just okay results. They were not that useful as such. Now they thought of making natural proteins and converting their active centers into our useful so that it could cause Diels-Alder reaction, it could catalyze Diels-Alder reaction by incorporating a copper II. But the problem was it showed good enhanced selectivity, no doubt. But the problem was it took literally several days to conduct this reaction. I mean, are you even a catalyst if you're doing this? Come on. So what would be an ideal enzyme? Okay, what do we expect from an ideal enzyme? So one chemical perspective, it should have regioselectivity and stereoselectivity, or else your product is either useless, or if you use it in a biological system, it might become toxic. Okay, and industrial point of view, you need only a small amount of your catalyst should be able to do the work. Okay, it's not like you take tons of catalyst and do the work. It's not how catalyst work. Okay, and high reaction rates. Of course, time is money for industries, so they need it. They need everything quick. Okay, so what does the current enzyme have to offer? Like whatever we're discussing in this paper, what does that enzyme have to offer? So we have high regioselectivity, very good. Stereoselectivity, nice. Stereoselectivity of reaction pathway, as in this also comes under stereoselectivity a little bit. Endo-exo products, we'll discuss it later. But this is nice, okay? But more importantly, we have a turnover number of about 10,000, which means that each catalytic center can catalyze or consume 10,000 molecules before it degrades. Okay, and the most important property is it is the fastest Diels aldrich ever created. Okay, so let's look into what reaction is discussed in this paper, and then we'll see how this was designed. So we have azacalcone and 3-vinylindole as our substrates, which are about to become the Diels aldrich and heterodiels aldrich products. So Diels aldrich product is common. So I'll show you. This is your diene. This is your dienophile. So interact and you'll get react and you'll get this Diels aldrich product. Or you have this heterodiene kind of thing and this dienophile. Okay, so you'll form this heterodiels aldrich. This will be in detail discussed by Madhur, and I'm going further from here. So experimental data shows us that this heterodiels aldrich product, this is measured by a very nice factor, like 1:19 is very nice. Okay, we have good enhanced like purity and stuff. Also, the endostereoisomer is preferred over exo by 18:1. So this is also very nice selectivity, right? So how does our catalyst have all these properties? And how was this thing designed? Now, it was completely designed from the scratch with a 97 amino acid long single chain protein. This is MID1SC. This is the name of the protein. It is used just as a template. Okay, so you modify this thing to whatever you want. All right. So basically, you modify the MID1SC gene and then convert it into a protein, and then that is the useful thing we need. Okay, so as of this thing, MID1SC does not have any catalytic or metal binding properties. Okay, but so it does not have any properties as catalytic properties also. So what they did, they ran DFT calculations, and there were two mutations suggested. That is, one is E23L, E32L, and E68W, which means, for this notation means that on 32nd position, you change the glutamic acid E into leucine, okay, and so on. So K, changing K to W on the position of 68, okay. So once they did this, the actual results turned out to be very nice, and the protein and zinc combination already showed a rise in twofold about of the catalysis rate of reaction basically. Okay, so this enzyme, they named it as DS0. Okay, Diels aldrich 0. This is the zero generation. Okay, and then they took this protein of DA0 and subjected it to directed evolution. Now now we need to understand what is directed evolution. This, by the way, this work was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2018. So it's very recent. Okay, so I'll vaguely explain how this works. Let's say I have a gene. Okay. Let's say I have the MID1 SE gene itself. Okay. So now what I do, I subject it to mutation, maybe random, maybe targeted. If you have calculated guesses, that's fine. But on the first cycle, if you are doing random mutations, that is fine. So from these genes, we make proteins. Okay. And we take each class of protein, each class of whatever protein is formed, and react it in a kind of reaction vessels. These kind of vessels, they are very small reaction vessels, kind of. Okay. So now what we check here is their ability to perform Diels-Alder reaction. Okay. In our case, of course, this is a very generalized mechanism, but in our case, we take each of these protein, put zinc, and then try and see how good these do the Diels-Alder reaction. Okay, so say these three are doing good reactions, and rest of them are not. So we just dump them here and take these three and take them for another round of mutations. Now these mutations are targeted. I mean, random, there are some random mutations, but most of them are targeted, so that you know where your next goal is, what position of amino acid you have to work on. Okay, so this is directed evolution. So this is what is the scheme of this paper. So MID1SC, this is the naive protein. So they just do two computational mutations, so they get DA0, the enzyme. Okay. And now they subject them to cassette mutagenesis and combinatorial shuffling. Now let me explain these two terms. First of all, cassette mutagenesis. Say suppose you have a DNA sequence, a small for that matter, and you take a fragment out of it and replace it with whatever you want. Okay, so. This is an oligonucleotide, double-stranded nucleotide chain. So a very small piece can be replaced in the DNA sequence. So why is this the cassette mutagenesis? Because it is very efficient, and it is most of the times it is correct. Like whatever you have planned, that will happen, and it is very site-specific. Okay. So if you want to do mutagenesis at a specific site, if you induce mutation at a specific site, you use this method. Okay. Now combinatorial shuffling. See, if I have let me explain you with this thing. So I have six amino acid chain. Okay, six amino acid long chain. So these are, as you know, this is one letter representation of amino acids. Okay. Now residue number three, I allow mutations, but only these three. Like K can be replaced by either L or Y. Okay. And residue number six, I allow mutations only these X or S. Others, these kept in blue, they are not mutated. They are not allowed to be mutated. Okay. So what we get is this number of possibilities. Okay, so this is kind of targeted shuffling, right? So you know, either this mutating either this or this might help your new generation of your protein. Okay, so choosing only a few residues and allowing them to mutate in a very restricted manner, this is combinatorial shuffling. Okay, now back to how we got our first generation Diels-Alder. So this is DA0. Now eight residues were chosen. Say out of the 97 chain, like 97 residues in the amino acid, eight of them were identified, and they were subjected to cassette mutagenesis. Okay, so they knew specifically what mutation is to be induced, and they did that. Now resulting variants, they were screened off, as in they were checked how good they did the Diels-Alderase function, and based on that they were selected. Now from those, again, five residues, five of the 97 amino acids, or five residues, 97 amino acid residues. So they were put through restricted combinatory shuffle. Okay, again, same thing. You are allowing these five residues to change, but only like limited changes, not completely new changes. Okay, now again, these were screened, and then you get the first generation DA1, that is Diels Alderase 1. Okay, so this is known as a combinatory library, this thing. So it shows you, say, suppose I have 35th position, these many changes are allowed. Okay, at 38th position, these many. So all the combined, we get variety of proteins, right? So if you make different combinations, you get a lot of calculated variation in the protein population. Okay, I'll call it protein population. Sorry. Okay. So Diels Alderase 1. So now let's get to the directly to the main enzyme, that is Diels Alderase 7. Okay. So how was that created? This DA1 was subjected to two cycles of error prone, that is random mutations, error prone PCR. This is a thing. So if you put the DNA of this thing in this PCR, so it will deliberately make errors so that it generates random mutations. Okay. Then again, focused mutagenesis on few residues, few selected residues, and combinatory shuffling on some other residues. Okay, and there we have DA7, your protagonist of whole paper. Okay, so for people interested, this is the whole combinatory library. So all of these changes were made for the first DA0 to DA1 conversion. This was the protein, the combinatorial library. For DA1 to DA4, that's what they called, that's the second generation catalyst. DA4 was, it was called, and for DA4 to DA7. Okay. So this is the structure of your DA7 enzyme. Now, say remove all these orange and magenta circles, like spheres. Okay. This is zinc. Okay. Don't confuse with that. So whatever remains is your MID1SC. Okay. That's the precursor of this. So now they induced two mutations, computed mutations. Okay, so this was DA0. Similarly, with all the evolutionary mutations here, it got DA7 got its structure. Okay, so this is the entire sequence of 97 amino acid sequence of right from DA0 to DA1, DA4, and DA7, everything. Okay, so we can see some changes here. Like, for example, say this is the 35th amino acid, right? It was changed from H to C, histidine to cysteine, it was changed. Okay, similarly, we can see like generation after generation, there were some changes. Okay, now DA7 in total compared to the MID1SC has 12 mutations. Okay, most important of them were I64G, H39V, and H35C. So we'll look into it, why it is important. So structural consequences of these mutations. The DA7 is made up of two helix turn helix motifs. Okay, I'll show the HTH motifs. Okay. Now because of this mutation, better let me show the, yes, this thing first. So this white H1, H2, this is one helix turn helix. Okay, then this is helix turn helix. So this, there are two of such HTH motifs, each in MID1SC as well as in this DA7. Okay, but now you see the major changes. H1 and H2, they are kind of superimposed for the comparison. So H1, with respect to H1, H2, H3, H4 are at some angle, but the angle gets reduced by more than 30 degrees. You see, more than they have calculated it, and it is more than 30 degrees. So that has some consequences. Okay. why did that happen? Also, firstly, because see, this is MID1. Okay, in this you have H39, that is histidine 39, and it has this nitrogen which can bind to zinc in, and it kind of coordinates with the zinc. Okay, while in H35, that is 35th position, you do have a histidine, but it is pointed away from the coordination sphere, right? But now in DA7, when the structure is all modified, this is why the actually structure is modified. So histidine is changed to valine. So now this is just a hydrocarbon, and it cannot form any coordinative interaction. While this histidine, 35th histidine, was changed to cysteine. Now this has a sulfur atom, which can coordinate with the zinc atom. Okay, so basically, the interaction from 39th position was removed, and it was introduced in 35th position. And this is why you get the change, the 30 degree change in this whole protein. Okay. Also, this I64G change, what it does, it creates a hydrophobic pocket inside the core, the cavity of inside the core of this protein, so that it can nicely fit in both diene and dienophile, and so that they are not disturbed by the external environment. Okay, so it can nicely accommodate both these things, and the reaction can happen very nicely. And they're just protected and well placed, I can say. Okay, so this was my part. Catalysis and further topics will be discussed by Madhur. Thank you all for listening. I'll stop sharing my screen.
Thank you, Advait.
Just share my screen now. Is my screen visible?
Yes, Madhur, it is.
I will start. So, as Advait told, we have carried out successive evolutions and mutations to finally form the DA7 protein, which catalyzes the Diels-Alder reaction. Now, we will see the kinetics in which this DA7 protein catalyzes the reaction. So, using kinetic studies, it was found that the catalytic rate constant of this reaction is 10 second inverse, and the dependence of the reaction rate and this concentration of substrate carried out, and it was plotted. And we can see here that the Michaelis-Menten constant is the pointer. Michaelis-Menten constant for M1 is the azachalcone, it is 82 micromolar. And for the 3-vinyl indole, it is 160 micromolar. The Michaelis-Menten constant is the concentration of substrate at which the velocity of the reaction is half of the maximum. So it is somewhere here. So the similar plots. Okay. So catalytic efficiency, this is a concept. It is given by K-cat divided by the product M1 and KM2. So we try to find out catalytic efficiencies for the earlier generation catalysts, like the DA1, DA4. And we saw that over the course of evolution, the catalytic efficiency has increased by a lot. From DA0 to DA1, it has increased by 100 times. With DA1 to DA4, it has increased 250 times. And DA4 to DA7, 5.6 times. So what has led to the increase in the catalytic efficiency as we move from DA0 to DA7? So this is because of the increase in K-cat by a factor of 60, decrease in KM1 by a factor of 12, and the decrease in KM2 by a factor of 18. So numerator increases and denominator decreases. This will lead to a very high catalytic efficiency. So there is another concept that is called as the catalytic proficiency. It is the ability of the catalyst to lower the energy of the transition state in the rate limiting step. Now it is given by K cat by KM1 into KM2. This is the catalytic efficiency, and this is divided by the K buffer. K buffer is the rate of the reaction in the absence of the enzyme. This is also equal to the 1 by KTS, where 1 by KTS is the apparent transition state binding affinity. For DA7, this value of catalytic proficiency was calculated to be 2.9 into 10 power 10 molar inverse. So if we compare this value against all the earlier generation catalysts and also some naturally occurring catalysts that catalyze the Diels-Alder reaction, we see that DA7 has an amazingly high catalytic proficiency value. Remember, this is a log scale. So increase in 1 point is an increase in the catalytic proficiency by a factor of 10. So what is the reason for such a high catalytic proficiency of DA7 enzyme? So this is because of the high effective molarity. Effective molarity is the ratio of the K-cat by the K-buffer. And the second reason is because of the relatively tight binding. Tight binding leads to a low value of KM1 and KM2. So we will talk about the regioselectivity now. So as Advait showed earlier, the two reactors can react in two separate ways. So here in the first type, this will act as the dienophile, which is electron poor. There are electron withdrawing groups here. This is a carbonyl and COOH. So this is electron poor. And this will be the electron rich diene. There is a nitrogen in the side. So this will donate its lone pair to the diene. And this will lead to the Diels-Alder product, the normal Diels-Alder product. Whereas if we consider this as the diene, it will be electron poor, and this will be the electron rich dienophile, and this will lead to the hetero Diels-Alder product. So these two products are formed by different mechanisms. So this is by the normal electron demand pathway, where the diene homo, the homo of the diene, interacts with the LUMO of the dienophile to give the product. Whereas here it is the inverse electron demand pathway, where it is the LUMO of the diene and the HOMO of the dienophile. So it is exactly opposite of the top pathway. In the presence of a zinc catalyst, the reaction completely undergoes an inverse electron demand pathway, which will lead to only the hetero Diels-Alder product. You can see it from the zinc coordinated intermediate here. The nitrogen and oxygen are coordinated with the zinc. So it will give its electrons to the zinc center, and the electrons will not be available for the dienophile. Hence, So the diene will be electron poor, and it will lead to an inverse electron demand pathway. So we know that only the hetero Diels-Alder product can be formed in the presence of zinc ion. So we will ignore the other side products, like the normal Diels-Alder products. But we see that there are two chiral centers in the hetero Diels-Alder product. So there will be 2^2, that is 4 stereoisomers formed. So after this reaction, this is the diene, and the dienophile can attack in this fashion, in which these two groups are just below the pi backbone. There will be a secondary interaction between these two groups and the pi backbone, and it will lead to this transition state. There is another way in which this can react. This is the diene, and the dienophile can come in such a way that these two groups are opposite to the pi backbone. This we see that this transition state will lead to the endo products, that is the SS and RR products, whereas this transition state will lead to the exo products. The RS and SR, these are two separate enantiomers. These are not the same thing. So when we use DA7 to catalyze the reaction, we see that it is highly stereoselective. Only the endo 4R6R product is formed, hetero Diels-Alder product is formed, that too with 99% enantioselectivity. You can see it from the HPLC chromatogram here. For DA7, there is only one peak. When we use just a zinc coordinated catalyst, we see that there are many other peaks. This will correspond to the 4R6R, as we see here, and this will correspond to the 4S6S endo product, and the small peaks here will correspond to the exo products. Similarly, it was the HPLC chromatogram was found for the DA0 catalyst, the first catalyst that was formed after from MID1SE. So this gives both the 4R6R endo product and the 4S6S endoproduct. And there is some little bit of exoproduct here. So this shows a very poor enantiomer selectivity. But we know that DA7 and DA0 both have similar transition state. Then what is between the enantiomer selectivities of these two catalysts? So first reason is because of the higher turnover number of DA7 catalysts. So there are more number of conversions to the optically pure product at normal standard temperature. We don't need to heat it to form the product. Whereas DA0, the turnover number is pretty less. And the second reason is because of the interaction of the transition state with the protein scaffold. So how does this happen? Next slide, we'll see. Interaction of transition state with the protein scaffold. So this is the diene, and we know that only the endoproduct can be formed. The dienophile can either come from the top, and this transition state will be formed. And this will give us the endo4S6S product. Whereas if for the dienophile comes from the bottom side, and this transition state form, this will give us the endo4R6R product. See the difference, both are endo, but the absolute configurations are different for both. So the yellow thing here, you can see in this protein structure that this is the yellow transition state and this is the green transition state. So for the yellow transition state, you can see that there is a choice between the zinc coordination and reduction of steric clashes. The C35 here undergoes steric clashes with this dienophile if we have a good zinc coordination. So it has to choose between the two. And what it does, it reduces the steric clashes at the expense of zinc coordination. Here you can see that the steric have been reduced with the dienophile, but the zinc coordination has been compromised. The bond distance between this diene and the zinc center has been increased. Here it is 2.6 and here it is 4.1. But for the endo product, there is a strong zinc, coordination with the diene. And also there is no steric clashes. We can see that there are no steric clashes here. This seems to be a steric clash, but it is not actually. Why this is not a steric clash here? So these two factors stabilize this transition state, the transition state that leads to the endo 4R 6R product. So there are some other factors that lead to the stabilization of transition state. So first is that the N-terminal helix, this is the N-terminal helix here. This has many van der Waal contacts with the diene, which stabilizes it. And the arginine 20, it has a guanidium group, three nitrogens, and this will form a salt bridge with the carboxylate group of this diene. Next is that the dienophile will bind with the C-terminal helix. This is the C-terminal helix, and this is the dienophile. It will bind with it in the small hydrophobic pocket formed by the I64G mutation. As Advait told before, there is a hydrophobic pocket formed due to the I64G mutation, and it will cause both the reactants, the dienophile and the diene, to safely stay inside this pocket. And this will cause the vinyl part of the dienophile stay against the C face of the diene and make the reaction go even faster. The external environmental factors don't affect this reaction. We can react really, really nicely here. So more factors that stabilize transition state are the hydrogen bonding. There is a hydrogen bonding interaction between the indole ring, the nitrogen of the indole ring, and the amide side chain of the glutamine 80. There is another hydrogen bonding interaction between this glutamine 31 and the tyrosine 84. This can be seen from the molecular dynamics simulations of this transition state. There are fluctuations in the hydrogen bond distances, but most of the time it is really close. So we see that the hydrogen bonding between these two, glutamine 31 and the tyrosine 84 residues, are pretty constant in the transition state. So all these factors stabilize the transition state that leads to the 4R, 6R product. That is why we only see that product with 99% enantioselectivity. So in the conclusion, I would like to say that evolution of the enzyme provided complete control over reaction pathway and the stereochemistry. We have seen that before, how the protein scaffold controlled the stereoselectivity and the regioselectivity was controlled by the zinc ion. So we can also try to form the other isomers like the endo-4S6S or even the exoisomers. But for doing this, we will have to try to change the structure of the protein in such a way that those specific transition states get stabilized. In our case here, the transition state for the endo-4R6R is stabilized. But if we try to stabilize for the transition state of the endo-4S6S, then we will get only this product. We can try to do that, but for evolving such a protein that will catalyze only the formation of endo-4S6S would require more challenging computational methods. So the difficult part while designing an enzyme is choosing a starting scaffold. But we already know that MID1SC, this can carry out Lewis acid catalysis as we saw in this reaction. So we can use this MID1SC and evolve it to carry out other Lewis acid transformation, Lewis acid catalyzed transformation. And this will provide a new avenue for designing and evolving biocatalysts of value. So thank you. I would like to end here.
Thank you, Adhisan Madhur. That was an amazing presentation. So we'll open this thing for questions and remarks from the audience. Anyone? Like, you can either raise your hand and speak, or you can type in the chat box directly. Yeah. Yes, Rohan, please go ahead.
Thank you, Advait and Madhur, for this amazing presentation and making this easy presentation from this difficult paper. So I have a question to Advait. In the structural consequences part at the end you discussed, so we saw that the change of the amino acid from histidine to cysteine made the coordination actually possible, and then the hydrophobic pocket formation and all those easier pathways are available. I mean, the, as the Madhur discussed in the latter part, interaction of transition state with the protein scaffold. So why they, like, what was the motivation from changing the amino acid from histidine to cysteine? I mean, with the sulfur containing amino acid.
Okay, nice question. So I'll just go back and present this thing. Oh, so you're talking about this one, right?
Yes, yes.
Sorry. Wait. maybe it is not exactly a targeted change. This might be even, you know, by chance. Like, so they had, one second. Where do I, okay. Okay, so all these mutations and all, they were first calculated on these things. Like, they did DFT calculations, okay? And then they decided what... So you exactly don't know what mutation will lead to what structure, right? Or else the whole protein folding problem is a myth. But so what you do is you change some specific sites which are very close to this coordination sphere, okay, and then you might end up with one of, so you have a large population of your proteins, and one of them is gives you the most out of it, like gives you the best out of it, I must say. So it is targeted, but not exactly to one structure, okay? So they targeted around this region, the mutations. They even did not, might not know that this mutation is going to occur, and this is why what do you say, this might help in some way. But it was a chance. Like, first they saw that this was giving very nice results, and then they went on and did the 3D modeling and all, and then they understood ki, this diene and ienophile, they are fitting perfectly because of the I64G mutation, and this this mutation, this H35C and H39. So it's not exactly like what was the point of doing this, more like when they studied why this particular protein, DS7 protein, why it was giving so much of catalytic property, that to selectivity and rate and everything, they found out that this was the reason. I would like to put it that.
Okay. So they have DFT calculation data, and so they have tried.
They make targeted guesses. It's like not guesses, but targeted.
Targeted cases, and among them it worked very nicely.
There might be some other which was close, but not that close. So
not that much.
This one worked out perfectly.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah, so Shreyas says that he would like to know more about the self-healing polymer you mentioned in the presentation as well.
Sure.
Yeah, maybe don't just keep presenting, I guess.
Okay, so, sure. I thought that was there might be a question from Madhav too, right? That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. This one, where is it? So see, you have, say this is your polymer and you have given it a cut, okay? So what you do is, this is a small cut, so they have two different lengths, like two different distances to which the cuts were made. So this is around 30 microns. So what they did is, now the bond distance or disulfide bonds, they were of short range. Okay. Better if I have one second. I don't have. Okay. So I'll try and explain here. So they just found out that short distance bonds were healed by your disulfide bonds. Okay. How exactly? I'll tell you. So basically, say you give a cut, then some random bonds are like broken, right? So instead, what you do, you heat the whole molecule at 60 degrees. So everything is molten now. Everything becomes one, and you cool it down. Okay. So if you cool it down, it again, like it changes from like a liquid to a solid. You see, not exactly a liquid, but it changes to a kind of, fluidic state to again solid state when it is brought back to 25, like your room temperature. So this is for your disulfide bonds. Now, if you take this Diels-Alder, so if you give bigger cuts, so you need stronger covalent bonds in order to heal them. Okay, the mechanism is same. So you do everything retro Diels-Alder, so everything separates out, and you get a very nice continuous pattern. And then you cool it down again, you'll automatically form a Diels-Alder. So I guess that made sense.
Yes. Thank you, Adit.
Yes, thank you. I'll keep presenting the slide itself.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, I am. You are. Please go ahead.
Can you explain how the targeted mutations are conducted?
Sorry, you're not audible.
How the targeted mutations are conducted?
Target.
I believe he's asking how the targeted mutations were conducted.
Yes.
Oh, so what they do is, so first of all these are computationally evaluated sites. Like, you don't randomly take, for example, this one. You don't randomly take eight different residues and go on, right? So you need some kind of, say, you give it to a this thing, no? Like you calculate the density functional theory. Using density functional theory, you calculate what is, if I want to get this structure, some structure, so what mutations might help. So you know, right, each amino acid gives a different kind of angle change to the entire amino acid chain. Okay, so based on that, not exactly how they targeted is important, but what do you say? Say suppose you want to get a circle from a straight. So first, what you do, you choose some points and then try and bend it, right? So you might get a polygon. Now what you do, you just take another some points on the straights which you might like need to bend to make it a circle. So you do this n number of times, you'll end up with a circle, something of that sort. Does that make sense?
Also, I am asking that if we put a mutagen, how will it specify the site where the mutation will occur?
Wait. I'm sorry. Again, please.
If we put the mutagen, how will it determine the site at which the mutation will occur?
Oh, that is done by this site-specific processes. No, I told you. This is cassette mutagenesis. So you can target this very small, like oligonucleotide, oligo double-stranded DNA to a very, very specific point, very specific place, and replace it. Okay, so this you can do. Also, this is, what is it? You have many targeted DNA changing, what is it? Nucleotide changing methods, right? Endonucleases, they have very specific sites where they cut, right? So you can have such methods for doing the targeted mutations in your gene. That will bring out the changes in your amino acids. Is it fine?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, I have a question. The presentation was really beautiful. It spans so many concepts and you both explained it clearly. So my question is that I might have missed it, but why does the enzyme only allow hetero disorder and not that disorder, normal disorder?
Okay,
Madhur, go ahead. Okay, so I told you about two mechanisms, right? The inverse mechanism and the normal mechanism, in which normal electron demand pathway and inverse electron demand pathway. And in the inverse electron demand pathway, the electron, the diene is electron poor and the dienophile is electron rich. While this zinc is coordinated to the diene, it makes it electron poor. That is why only that inverse electron demand pathway is followed. Do you understand?
Okay. Yeah, I might have missed it. Yeah. Does anyone else have any more questions? If anyone has no further questions, then we can finish the session. We would like to announce one thing that we will be holding author sessions from subsequently, like maybe like in the next session or next to next. So I hope you enjoyed this one, and
before we all leave, I see a lot of people are leaving right now. So before you all leave, I would request all of you to please turn on your cameras once, and we'll have this customary screen. Come on, people. Is it my internet are people not turning their cameras on?
Yeah, it's your internet.
That's sad. Somebody get a nice screenshot, please.
Manna, are you taking?
Some people are leaving because they don't want to take their
because
photos.
Of the camera thing.
Yes. No, my net is not that good. Just anyone.
Okay, take? I am taking. Just give me 10 seconds. So everybody say cheese or whatever comes to your mind, you know. Just give me 5 seconds. Yeah. So yep. Let me take another one. Sorry for the delay. Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Done. Thank you all for it.
Cool. So we can answer for an author session.
Yeah, before ending, I want to again thank Advait and Madhur for making this beautiful presentation. Not because like we can see their effort, like how elaborately they discussed
every.
And it also spans all the things we read, like Diels solder reaction and all, and also includes the advanced topics like how, not how, but what they did actually to do the
I haven't seen any application of director evaluation anywhere. Like it was the first time for me to.
Yes, also like they exposed us to it, and also very nicely. That's why. Thanks again for your efforts.
Thank you so much, Rohan.
Thank you.
Okay. Goodbye then.
Yeah, goodbye.
Acha, wait. I want to say something to the. Oh, Advait, go went. Okay, fine. So I didn't attend the entire talk. हाँ सुन रहे हो ओ हेलो हेलो क्या कर रहे हो बढ़िया मधुर तो तुम्हारा पार्ट हम सुने नहीं ज्यादा बट लाइक फ्रॉम व्हाट आई कुड सी फ्रॉम द स्निपेट्स ऑफ इट लाइक एक्चुअली फ्रॉम अ बायोलॉजिस्ट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू इट वाज वेरी वेल एक्सप्लेन्ड आई डिडंट फील कि लाइक केमिस्ट्री में बहुत डीप जा रहे हो या समथिंग लाइक मे बी समवेयर वेर यू नीडेड टू एक्सप्लेन मे बी आई मिस्ड दोस स्लाइड्स दैट्स व्हाई आई एम सेइंग दिस बट लाइक आई फेल्ट लाइक It was a very accessible talk, you know, like, and so kudos for that.
मेरे को POC के flashbacks आ रहे थे, ऐसे वो dial solder ये.
Actually Advait चला गया नहीं तो Advait का part actually I like उसमें biology बहुत लगा मेरे को लगा.
बुलाते हैं ना.
I'm attending a biology talk actually, not a chemistry talk.
Yeah, I'm starting the recording video. Actually, I did not even stop the recording.
Oh yeah, sure.